It's a bit where I dance.
Oh yeah.
Just get your groove on. Do it. Good morning, gang. How's everybody?
Hey, oh. I'm good.
Oh, how are your eyes, Brent? You said they were dry.
I'm feeling a little dry this morning, but
yeah.
The steam from the coffee is acting as a fine lubricant.
Right, or maybe just the embarrassment of having to watch me dance. It's bringing
maybe
a tear
that
to your
was
eye.
It.
Yeah. Yep. Excellent. Do you need a tissue?
Tissue.
Hey gang, hello to everybody in the chat. Hope you're all having a great morning.
Yeah.
The question is being asked, is it true it never rains in Southern California? And that question is also being answered. It's gray and dreary here today in Eastern Ontario as we shift from winter mode to spring mode. Activate spring mode. Chwing. Anyway, we have a great guest with us this morning. Where are we going? Well, that's caffeine kicking in there, boys. Anyway, we have a great guest with us this morning. First time with us, Fergal Connolly. Fergal, give us an introduction to yourself.
Hello, everyone. My name is Fergal. I'm based in Dublin, sunny Dublin today, which is strange for us. Worked in L&D 7-8 years, variety of different positions. Recently found my calling in the topic of learning transfer, and I'm here to share with you all today.
Most excellent, and that is very much the subject of what we're. Let's start with that phrase, learning transfer. Do you have a definition that you prefer?
So learning transfer, it's something that we don't really think about it too much. We kind of assume it happens a lot of the time. It's basically someone taking what they learn in a training environment, and they take that back to the role and they implement it. It sounds really, really straightforward. It's massively complex. It rarely happens.
And it was such a tradition in our world, too, of just telling people information, for instance, and presuming that understanding and application will result out of that. We gave you the PowerPoint.
Exactly.
So it is something, even though it's simple and seems obvious, it's something that still is a struggle in this industry of ours. Yeah,
absolutely. And it took me, honestly, I stumbled across this topic. I assumed I was delivering effective and impactful training sessions for years. Mm-hmm. And one day I was researching, I can't remember exactly what the topic of the article was, and just this topic of learning transfer, and it just opened my eyes and it made me think, have my learners done anything? And I was like, I don't think they have. Well, I'm not sure if they have. And I dug into the research. I can show you some of the general findings today, and it's very, very rare.
Mm-hmm.
So you know what, let's dial back a little bit and just help people get to know you a little bit. When you're talking about this and you're talking about, in the early days of your training, what did that look like? And how did you kind of get into this space? Have you always wanted to be a trainer? I know we all grew up in school and said, I want to be a trainer.
Exactly. Yeah.
Not really.
Before I answer that, do you mind if I change audio? I can hear myself talking directly after I say something. It's very, very, very distracting.
Yeah.
Will I?
Quick swap.
I'm just going to change.
Musical interlude.
Yes.
Quick, sing something, Chris. My audio is a little low. Dang it.
Yeah.
Dang it. I'm going to try to
You're
stay.
Breaking up.
I'm going to try You're to breaking stay, up. Stay on top of my microphone today, people.
And Joe, if for anybody's catching in the chat, Lightbulb Joe has posted to her Twitter feed both an idiotic mug and a Guinness glass in honor of Fergal's Dublin location. Yeah. I'm hearing more room noise now than before. So I wonder if you switch now to your
Computer. Yes, that was actually a worse delay here. We've got to get rid of these.
You know what that echo could be that you're hearing? You might have an additional tab open of Crowdcast. That happens a couple times. So check all your tabs, all your browsers, and make sure you've only got Uno. Well, except, you know. Oh, there you go.
All right.
Hello.
Just the regular voices, but not the, you know, the ones that I'm projecting to you guys. All right. We're back.
All righty. Very good. Brent was asking, you know, sort of what were you doing? What were the kinds of things that you were doing before you discovered learning transfer? And then in upon reflection, were maybe not good things that or the best things that you could have been doing?
Sure. I suppose I stumbled into training a little bit. I think many of us did. I've always been interested in people and the people side of things, why we do things, the how of behavior and that kind of thing. So I did my bachelor's degree in psychology. And I was interested in learning. I am interested in how to be the best learner I could, but didn't really think of it as a career in any way. So college completed, got my bachelor's, started my first job, just kind of like an entry level kind of job, nothing to do with training in any way. But obviously when I started my job, I had to go through onboarding. And I was sitting there in onboarding and I realized that a lot of the concepts that I'd learned in the psychology degree, they were being taught to me, but they were being used by the trainer to teach me and how to take on information and how to kind of apply this in my role. And that was like a light bulb moment for me to say, like, this is a place where I can use my everything I just learned and use it to help other people to grow. So back then I didn't know I was interested in learning transfer, but that moment right there was like, I want to apply my learning. I want to take that 4-year degree that I did and actually use it every day to help other people. So I was very lucky. In that same company, I got a position as a training facilitator. So I helped people get onboarded, told them about the company, all the different tools that they needed to use, the teams that they were going to join, the adjacent teams, all sorts of things. I really loved it. Loved, you know, seeing the light bulbs going on in people's eyes, which you kind of, you brought them in. They didn't know a huge amount, but when they left, you could see that they knew. And it was written all across their faces. And I really loved that. But, you know, facilitation, there's probably a lot of facilitators in the chat right now. It's exhausting. You're on your feet all day. There's a lot of talking. It can really, really take it out of you. And while I was excited and I was happy that with the impact that I was helping people to learn, I wanted to kind of broaden that horizon. That's how I got into the wonderful world of learning design. I was like, I can kind of turn these lights on across the world or across the different learner bases that we have for the different companies. So absolutely love learning design, love solving problems using something creative, love the visual design aspect of it, and love really kind of simplifying information to make it something that you can just read, understand, and then apply. But we'll get to the apply part later on. So loved that side of it as well. And then I turned, current role is a learning consultant. So obviously as learning designers, we're using a lot of information. We're getting a lot of information from, in my experience, it would be someone else who does the analysis side of things. And then they pass that to me. I use that the best way I can to create the best learning that I can and I send that on. So I felt like for me to be the best learning designer I can be, I need to be that person at the top of the funnel, if you know what I mean. So to get that information, to understand the business so that I can kind of create a blueprint that's really going to help people to understand and to learn. So I've been trying to put different pieces of my skill set together from the facilitation side of things, the design and the consultancy, to kind of be the best that I can be. And in that journey, I was doing a lot of research, and I, like I said earlier, I stumbled across this topic of learning transfer. I can't remember the name of the article. It might've been The Great Training Robbery. I'll put it in the chat later on. I'll get it for you guys. The Great Training Robbery, and this promise that training makes, you know, we're going to make the company better, we're going to make the people better, but then actually it never really happens. Yes, they come to training, they have a great time, or they love the e-learnings, we nail the engagement side of things, but the change piece, how people are supposed to take that on and then, you know, be better, it just it doesn't happen as often as we would like.
Yeah, and it is always, I mean, it's the ultimate goal for what we're trying to do here is to either improve processes or improve people's performance in processes and make those changes. And so often we're really more just throwing info at people or and we might give them some great stories, you know, along the way, context, et cetera, as a, you know, from a presentation kind of a mode. But getting them to take that back and actually do it is really what we're supposed to be doing.
Exactly. It's about behavior change. We're trying to design someone's behavior. And like when you think about it like that, you know, giving them an e-learning, giving them a presentation, how effective is that going to be at changing someone's behavior? So that's where that kind of made my jaw drop when I had this realization, and I turned to the research. So there's a ton of academic research in this area, and the research really points to several different factors and several different levers that we can pull as learning designers, as instructional designers, in order to get the most bang for our buck and really, really kind of move the needle on learning transfer.
Very cool. Very cool. And I think you were showing us earlier in the green room some of your slide info that you've brought along. Maybe it's a chance to at least look at the first of those, because there was some info there about some statistical info, et cetera, to help us sort of give real context other than just us talking about this stuff.
Absolutely. Allow me to share my screen. Share screen. Share this screen. Okay, let me know if you can see this. All right.
There you go.
Having some issues with the projecting of the screen. I wasn't able to see you guys, wasn't able to see the chat. So if this is okay with you, and if you can see it okay,
it's big totally enough. Good. Yep.
Cool. So this is, I suppose, a simplification of what some of the research says. 10% of training works in general. Some of your training might be better, some of your training might not be as effective, but in general, 10% of training. So some of the research suggests that $366 billion, that's a mind-boggling amount of money, was spent on L&D in 2019. And if you think that only 10% of that training was actually effective, like how much of that money was wasted? I was thinking about the amount of hours I've spent in the classroom, telling people, on my feet, getting exhausted, really trying to help people to learn, and the amount of hours I've spent creating e-learnings. Making the most interactive and being as engaging as they possibly could be, and then for that to only have a 10% effect, it's really kind of really made me want to kind of understand this topic a lot more. So on the flip side, so I use an iceberg to kind of just as an analogy for learning transfer. So we all know the iceberg. We can see the 10% at the top, the bit that's easy to see. And we really have to look further below the surface if we really want to understand the full, get a real sense of the iceberg. The 10% is the things that we really focus on. So I'll get to that actually next slide. So the 10%, the things that we really focus on. So if you look at the top half of my iceberg, obviously I would have had a nice fade in effect. The top half of my iceberg. These are the kinds of things that we focus on. We focus on what people need to learn. We try to create the most interactive of e-learnings that we possibly can to drive up engagement. Engagement is good. Micro-learning, so spacing things out. We've always tracked those attendance rates, and we love a good L1 satisfaction survey. So I'm sure some of the people in the chat, you're doing a lot more than this. Some people might be doing less, but these are kind of how we generally attack a problem, such as, what do people need to learn? What do people need to do? We try to hit them with these kind of, with these main things. That's the tip of the iceberg. So, and that's why I feel like we're only getting to that 10% effective rate. It's because we're looking at it in such a, we're looking at it just the tip, and we are forgetting about the rest of this massive problem, which can be influenced. Yeah.
Let me play devil's advocate here a little bit, and just, there's so many variables, just like in the lower part of your iceberg here, right?
Yeah.
And I think, any of us that have been in the industry long enough, I think you can very quickly get a little jaded. I know I do at times that, it's just like you can lead people to the training room, but you can't make them learn, and you can't make them go back to their desk and actually apply what you tried so hard to design effectively for them and make them do it. And it can I mean, I think that's part of the exhausting part, right? And, you know, in the work that we do. So, I mean, how have you ever run into that? Or are you still too fresh and green to to have been jaded yet?
Thankfully, my energy levels for this are at an all-time high. I'm sure I will get tired. I will hit walls. There will be obstacles to overcome. But right now, I'm trying to get this research out there and really just share, just to try and, like, if people are like me, they didn't know about this. They assumed that everything was working out okay. You know, they were delivering the great training. They got those great kind of the thumbs up and the smile sheets and stuff like that. They were happy with it. But there's another side to people who want more, who really are in this game to really help people to grow through learning. And so that's what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to share as much research as I possibly can. I'm trying to share a lot of the academic, the applicable academic research that's out there. A lot of it is mind-bogglingly complex. I'm trying to simplify that and get it out there to people who can kind of turn it into something practical and use it every day really, really quickly. So I write a ton of articles. I publish them all on my website. I'll put the website into the chat soon. And I'm also starting a podcast as well. So just to kind of collect the kind of the key minds, I suppose, on learning transfer, put them in one place. Interview them, you know, really get a sense of the problems that they've faced, the challenges and how they've overcome those challenges. Put them all into kind of a simple kind of series of podcast interviews and get them out there. Just more ways for people to learn about learning transfer and more ways for people to turn their learning into action by taking the learnings from the experts.
Yeah. So in the diagram that you're showing us here, the top of the iceberg that we're currently seeing, these are the things, you know, that we commonly do already. And really they're the kinds of things that probably people expect from us, people who, you know, we report to, et cetera. They've seen training in the past and it has learning objectives and people, you know, are tracked in the LMS and smile sheets and those sorts of things. So in some ways, as I'm looking at this, I'm thinking, you know, we are living up to some of or most of the expectations, you know, of what most people that we might report to probably feel our job is. I mean, we're doing the job, right? But I guess the bottom half then is stuff that we could be doing better.
Yeah, and this is the stuff that the research would say is actually more influential than how we've been approaching it so far. So there's a big impetus on L&D. Businesses are getting smarter. They're really looking to how they can run their businesses more effectively, you know, cutting costs and these kinds of things. And L&D is a cost. And what are we doing? Where is the direct link between L&D, what we do every day, and the results of the business? So businesses are starting to look to us to kind of really be that to really kind of prove the return on investment of what we do. So the research on learning transfer would really point to these things that you can see kind of that are hidden, I suppose, at the bottom of the iceberg. So the learner side of things is huge. We do focus on the learner. We create learner profiles. I saw someone put that in the chat. But really understanding our learner, what our learner wants, what motivates our learner, and how do we motivate that learner? That's huge. Because it's the learner at the end of the day who's going to transfer. It's the learner who has to change or who is supposed to change. If they don't want to change, no change will happen. So it's really, really up to them. And we really need to understand that learner to influence those the variables that we can influence on the learner side of things. And then the other side of it is the performance context. So we give people training, it's in a learning environment, you know, it's safe, but then, you know, we send them out into the wilds of the performance environment, which is their workplace. You know, this is where they're supposed to turn their learning into action. And traditionally, as instructional designers, we don't really touch that place. You know, we've done our part, we've delivered that training, we created that e-learning, and then they're ready, and we don't really know what happens after that. So it's the performance environment, the culture of your workplace, the expectations for learning transfer, which are all set at the manager and above level, which are really, really influential when it comes to someone taking their learning and actually turning it into something that they change every single day.
That's the part that I think is different and has been changing slowly over the years. And that's that culture and the expectations of what the training department or what L&D is supposed to even be doing, right? Like when we look at a lot of this stuff, it's like you know, self-efficacy, accountability. These are all kind of traits and things like that. Like typically a manager or somebody wouldn't look to the training department to say, hey, you know, can you guys, you know, do manager coaching and feedback? You know, can, you know, we might be asked to train them on how to do manager coaching and feedback, but it's never really been our responsibility to follow up with them and say, hey, are you doing your manager coaching and feedback? You know, yeah. there's so many other parts of the business that that we need to impact, right? That we need to be a part of and engage with in larger systems thinking in order to impact all of these different things. And it's not as easy as just creating a training. And I think that's still the perception in a lot of organizations. Hey, even though you're learning and development, you're still just the training department. Can you just make me some training?
Exactly. Yeah, it's the perception of L&D. And we've been a part of building our own perception over the years. You know, we've only done so much, so people only expect so much. So if you want more, you kind of need to, you need to change how you behave, how you go to the business, how you talk to the business, and how you sell what you can really, really do. But yeah, the fact of the matter is you need more buy-in. A simple e-learning, a simple PowerPoint isn't going to change someone's behavior. You do need a more kind of, need to understand the entire ecosystem of what does actually change someone's behavior.
Yep. And how do we get there? I think is what, like, you know, hey, what,
the million dollar question.
Well, that's why you're here today.
This is it. I'm here to solve your million dollar questions. What I can do is I'm going to focus on the learning design side of things. And there are elements outside of learning design, such as the manager support and some learner elements as well, that we can try to influence with the learning design. And I'll come back to kind of the more kind of ecosystem side of things later on. So here's what the, if you can still see my screen, here's what the research says is the real influencers for learning transfer. So the learner, like I said, these are the ones who need to change. So understanding what they actually expect from training and what their expectations are for their job is huge. How much do they actually plan to implement from a training at all? The motivation, their self-efficacy, the accountability that they feel for their own growth, huge as well. And it really kind of, these are the things that will really determine if someone will go and change something after training. On the learning design things, probably a bit simple for the audience that we have here, but relevant content is one. Having a lot of practice and actually designing transfer into your designs. It's not just here's what you learn, and then go do. It's here's what you learn. You also do in a training, and then when you leave that training, you're so much more ready to actually keep on displaying that behavior. On the work environment side of things, you need to be able to practice. You need to be able to actually use what you've just learned about. From my own experience, I recently went through a fascinating training, about problem solving. It was project management. And there's a huge kind of Six Sigma lean element to it, which I thought was fascinating. The facilitator was amazing. He's one of the most engaging facilitators I've ever had the pleasure of joining a training with him. And the training was 9 hours spread over 3 weeks in three different sessions. It was huge. But I left that training so impressed, but I couldn't apply it. I didn't have opportunities to go and use that. And the rest of my team wasn't trained in the same methodology. So that 9 hours that I spent in a training, it was kind of a waste. But even though I enjoyed it, even though I got a lot from it, I didn't actually use anything. So having a chance to actually use what you learn, which sounds so simple, is massive in this arena. The manager support is huge. And I think this is one that we can really start to tweak from our learning design perspectives. The workplace culture, that's, you know, PowerPoint isn't going to change our workplace culture. This is something where we really need leadership buy-in. It's something that needs to come from that CEO level, that learning is rewarded in the company. Growth is rewarded. It doesn't happen all the time. If you can really implement this into your culture, you get so much more from it. Innovative and psychologically safe workplace. Along with the manager support, the peer support as well is huge. like I said, that example of me in the training last week, I had done a training, no one else on my team had. I was trying to implement a new process. They were using old processes. Imagine if we all went to the same training at the same time. We all came back with new ideas on implementing this new process. The behavior change would be so, so different. A manager coaching and feedback. So having a manager who understands what you're trying to do after a training. So you went to a communication skills training. How are you going to implement that? How can I help you to improve on your communication skills? Is absolutely massive. And these are the bits that we don't touch as instructional designers, as learning designers. These are the bits that really move the needle.
Have you ever been asked to, hey, can you build us a learning culture? I hear that a lot. I see people asking about it. And I've even seen on like LinkedIn and stuff where people will post, I've been asked to, I've been asked to build a learning culture. Does anybody have any resources? And I'm just sitting there thinking to myself, what? Really? Like, how do you build a culture?
I don't have an answer to that question. Like, a culture is built built in every conversation, in every interaction. You know, it's right. A lot of it's unsaid. Like, how do you build something that's so unsaid and so intangible? Yeah, it's huge.
I always try to just drop into the conversation and just try to explain to people that you're really going to get frustrated if you try to take on something like that, because one person can't do it. I mean, you might be able to influence, right? You can start a chain reaction of certain things by engaging with a lot of people and whatnot, but it might be a better start anyways to just figure out what the culture currently is and try to work around that and, just do the little things that you can influence. But wow, it always just kind of blows my mind when I hear people say, yeah, I'm responsible for changing the culture to a learning culture. I'm like, well, good luck with that.
Well, the place to start with that, Brent, is always you take a PowerPoint and you put it in a Petri dish and you add a little bit of moisture and then you close it up and you let it grow from there. Learning culture.
Right. If we only knew it was that easy. Well, we're done for today. There's your answer.
There we go. It's all done.
There's the $1 million question.
See you guys. Kidding.
Yeah. Wendy has a question that might be a good spot to slide in right here. Could you talk about the efficacy of learning transfer when a learner is on their own in self-directed training or outside of formal training? Because many of the things you've connected here are contextually, bringing in manager support, those sorts of things. Someone is going through something in much more of an is isolated the word, but without having, say, the work environment being a factor that we can affect on. It does strike me that some of these things, getting implementation intentions, getting people. The triggering buy-in or et cetera, or at least explicitly maybe stating that that they will, that simple act sometimes of simply having people state that, yes, I'm going to use this to solve this kind of a problem, et cetera. A lot of these triggers, though, I think still apply in that kind of context, don't they?
Oh, for sure. Learning transfer can still happen with none of these things. You just need to be highly, highly motivated and really, really want to change how you approach things. People change all the time. These are influences that in a learning and development, typical learning and development environment, these are all things that can kind of boost that typically ineffective learning transfer rate. So yes, learning transfer can happen if you've only got, like, let's say one, if you've got a highly motivated learner who is totally self-directed, knows exactly what they want to do and knows where they're going to change their behavior, it can still happen. But it's just those situations are extremely rare.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And Peter is asking a similar kind of a question in a sense. Many of these issues are organization centric, like manager support, like we were just discussing there. His training department group, they're externally focused. They help workers in other companies upskill their tech skills. So again, not an area where things like the organizational structure is something that you know Peter's group is even connected to, because they're providing you know courses and training sort of as a third party you know vendor kind of approach. But similar, I think, to Wendy's question, a lot of these things, particularly on the learner and the learning design, are still things that are still very valid in that model too, right?
Absolutely. I think if I've ever been involved in a situation where I've been dealing with external clients, but in that situation where you don't really have that influence, how hard would it be to have your tech skills training, whatever it is for the people who are going to increase their tech skills, but have a separate session for managers on how to support them, what the training is going to be that your guys are going through, how their tech skills will increase, and the situations where they might need some help. If you take a dual approach, you get your managers in one room, you give them one training, and you have your regular tech skills training for the people who are going to perform. I don't want to say that would change things, but like you said, culture is huge. And if you kind of take that dual approach, you'll have a much more kind of holistic, supportive environment there as well. Actually, there was some research I saw recently where that situation actually happened. Obviously, it wasn't an external training event, but I can share it with you guys. I posted recently on LinkedIn. I'm going to put it in the chat. And that was basically it. They did a 90-minute training on what the training was for the managers. Now, so your learners are going through a training. This is a 90-minute session on what exactly your learners are going to learn, the types of questions that you can ask to support your learner, and how to give people situations in which they can apply their learning after training. It was a 90-minute training. It was a one-time thing, but they saw transfer rates explode after that. And they did a compare and contrast between like an A test and a B test group. And there was huge, huge difference in that single 90-minute training.
Mm-hmm. And maybe before we depart from this particular slide here that we've got up on the screen, Vicky's got a question now that she's added. Is our role then to simply create as much excitement as we can about the learning within the confines of the culture and delivery mechanism, and try to point people in the direction of ways to apply the learning? And one of the things when I think about motivation, and I'm kind of honing in on Vicky's word excitement, because there's that excitement, that kind of thing sort of feels almost like, you know, we're cheerleaders, rah, rah, you know, root, root. But I think, you know, that's not always that kind of enthusiasm. Anyway, that can also sometimes not be particularly helpful in a sense. It creates false expectations, perhaps, or even simply eye rolls if people are overly enthusiastic about how great and awesome something's going to be. Sure. It sort of feels maybe though that there are other triggers that we can use for, and particularly around, say, you know, motivation, beyond just being enthusiastic and that kind of a cheerleading perspective too.
Sure. Yeah, great question. Excitement is important. It's really influential. Like, excitement gets us up and gets us moving. It gets us motivated to do something. I would just be careful what you create the excitement about. I would focus on what you're going to do after the training. So get people excited on how their skills are going to increase, or the situations where they're going to be able to apply what they learned. And that'll get people in the door coming to the training, but also excited to engage with what's going to happen then afterwards. I think generally we use the word engagement, but I think if you look at your pre-training communication phase as a real kind of how you, let's keep on using excitement, how you kind of get that that initial interest in your training. So just think about like a marketing campaign. Like this is what the last people on the training said. They said it was like this. These are your facilitators for this session. They've got these years of experience. They're coming at it from this angle. They've done their research on this topic. That kind of changes your perception of what this training is going to be and how you're going to behave after that training. So yeah, excitement is amazing. It just depends how you channel that excitement through your communications and through the session itself, in order for that to translate to change behavior.
Mm-hmm.
I think I'll just jump to the next slide because we were talking about it. So here's a few things. So focus on design, really. Here are a few things that that the research really points to when we get to evidence-based approaches to design. So I'll jump down to priming. So bottom left of your screen. This is something that we've seen in the research. By using active language instead of passive, you will learn or you will do this in the training. If you change that passive language to something more active, such as you will achieve or you will solve or you will be able to do X, Y, and Z after this training, that simple kind of change in phrasing really has a massive impact on people's interest and excitement in a training course and how they kind of perceive what they're going to learn and how they actually use that after the training as well. I'm adding priming there as well because Vicky's question made me think of our expectations for something. So
yeah.
if you recommend the last Netflix show you saw to me, I'm much more likely to see it, even if I've no interest in the genre. I don't really like that person who's in it. But you give me a glowing recommendation for that next Netflix show, I'm probably going to go and watch it. It's the same if we're buying something from Amazon. Like, do you spend $50 on the thing that has 5,000 four-star reviews, or do you spend $30 on the thing that has 300 like three-star reviews? You're probably going to spend a little bit more on the thing that a lot of people are saying is really, really good. So if you can kind of channel those positive experiences to kind of create like a marketing communications campaign before your training, it gets people bought in from the get-go. It really kind of shows people what they can do after that training. So I won't go into these in too much detail, conscious of time, and also we've got a very highly educated audience here today, but mirror the workplace. So make your training as close to possible as you can to what you're actually going to be doing on the job. People really need to see the link between this is what I'm doing in training and this is what I'm going to do after training. So by making it as similar as possible, you just get more bang for your buck that way. Practice is another one. Again, don't need to go into it in too much detail, but the research says that between 30 and 50% of your training should be active practice, 30 to 50%. So I was trying to think, like, I was recently at that 9-hour training I mentioned. What is that, 30 to 50%? That's 4.5 hours of practice. That is absolutely massive. But if you want people to change, you got to give them that practice time. You got to let them make mistakes in a training. You got to give them feedback in the training. And so in order for them to kind of take that afterwards, these are the kind of levels that we need to start getting to. So action planning, this is something that we mentioned earlier on, implementation intentions. So, and this is a really, really easy one for us to implement as learning designers. So towards the end of your training, you could do it on a whiteboard, you could send people a Google survey or any other kind of survey at the end. I asked them to kind of just make a note of the three key things that they learned and the three key things that they really want to change after the training. If you can get them to kind of just take a moment and think about that, what they're going to do after and when they're going to do it, that the research says will drive learning transfer and really kind of take people into that kind of not just learning phase, but actual doing phase. What else do we have? Modeling. Sorry, Chris, not like runway modeling, but it's more of a kind of, there you are. So modeling, so actually having an in-depth demonstration of what good behavior looks like. The behavior that you expect after the training, having a really solid demonstration of what that looks like after the training so people can go and do it. When I was putting together this slide, I was thinking of, do you guys remember there was a flight? I think it was a couple of years ago now. But it was a flight that had a lost cabin pressure or something like that. And the oxygen masks came down and everyone put on the oxygen masks. And a lot of people like took selfies and stuff like that. A lot of people, they put on the masks incorrectly. They were putting them on their nose, on their tongue, or just on their mouth. Apparently, a lot of people had done it incorrectly. But how many flights have you been on? How many times have you been shown how to put on an oxygen mask? And people are still getting it wrong. Like I've probably seen someone do that hundreds of times. But when push comes to shove, putting an oxygen mask on, chances are, you know, will you get it right? Will you get it wrong? I don't know. I've never practiced. I've never gotten feedback on it. So who knows what's going to happen? And that's a serious situation. So that's where modeling really comes in. If you're given a chance to watch someone do a demonstration, but then get some practice on it yourself, have some quick feedback, the chances of you making a mistake in that situation are, basically non-existent. So spacing, won't go into it in huge detail, but breaking the information up and giving small points, small piece of information over time. Another piece of information, or another stat I heard recently was we intake 34 gigabytes of information. Every day we intake 34 gigabytes of information. That's massive. So if your training is a part of that 34 gigabytes, which parts are they going to remember? That's a huge, huge amount of information. Some of it's going to get lost. Space it out to give people the best chance of remembering. If people don't remember it, they're not gonna be able to do anything with it. So learning is still key at the end of the day. And then finally, bottom right of your screen, manager support. So this is, if you look at all the research and you only take one point away from the day, having manager support for learning and learning transfer is the most influential factor on this entire area. So if you can get a manager bought in into supporting a learner, the chances of them doing something after that training are much higher than just giving your simple one and done training and leaving the learner to their own devices.
It's like it reminds me a lot of learning more about influence. I kind of went down that rabbit hole for a while, reading a lot of books on, how to be influential and what are all the things in getting people to change their mind, right? All the classic books, Getting to Yes and all that kind of stuff. And it just, the reason why I went down that rabbit hole was, I feel like that's kind of what we do as trainers, right? It's our job to influence people to change their behaviors and to do something else. So a big part of our design work needs to be influencing. And it's always great to see it show up, whether we call it influencing or good design, but priming is a big part of it. Modeling is a big part of it. Yeah. Mirroring is another big part of it, when you're interacting with other people and whatnot. And gaining support from others, just all of that stuff all fits in, and there's all those different pieces to it. So it's definitely something we all need to be looking into more. That's for sure.
Very cool.
Absolutely. And it's a complex area as well. It's human behavior. We haven't figured it out. Not L&D, not marketers. We're getting better. Advertisers haven't figured it out, so we're taking small steps. I think we'll get there eventually, but we just gotta take these little baby steps in the right direction.
Mm-hmm. Well, we'll keep talking about it every Wednesday morning, but probably running out of time today, eh, Chris?
Yep, we're getting close to a wrap. The other question that we haven't talked about in the question panel was there's a request for the slides, and Fergal, are you willing to share those from today?
Absolutely. Yeah. What's the best way? Well, I just send them to you, and you can.
So pop them over to us. We'll post a wrap up of today's session on the dominKnow blog. So we'll make a link there. Plus, we'll also provide them in the LinkedIn group that we've got. Which, if folks haven't heard, there's a LinkedIn group. Brent, if you've got the LinkedIn group link handy, people can jump in and join that, and keep in touch with us on a lot of levels. But like we said, Brent will post the slides up into there as well. So, and Fergal, toss in your own contact details here as we get ready to dance on out. Where places where people might connect with you or be able to find you, etc. And thanks as always to everybody in the chat. Lots of good points and questions and ideas coming and flowing. And I think somebody actually found your great training robbery link. There's a link in the chat that someone's put in.
Fantastic.
So that's brilliant. Yep, we've had a helpful bunch of folks here that join us every week. So
great chat room today, by the way. Thanks everybody for dropping all your stuff in there and helping us out and asking such great questions. As always, we love it. You guys are a big part of the show, just as much as our fantastic guest, Fergal Connolly, today. Thanks for joining us, man. It's good to
meet you. Thank you so much, everyone. Thanks, guys, for having me, and thanks to everyone on the chat. Do be in touch on the idiotic LinkedIn group. I'll be in touch later on. And have a great day.
Awesome. Thanks, everybody. Let's dance on out.
Let's do that. How about a little music?